In this series, looking at the conversion process that God has created for human beings to become members of his divine family at his throne forever, we have seen that this requires continuous miracles to take place, of which most humans are not aware. We don't tend to think about the ongoing miracles that take place. We have God's favor, referred to in Scripture as grace, but the favors of God to choose us from before the foundation of the world, to then give us a calling, the faith of him and his son, to give us the concept of repentance, to understand right from wrong, to understand his word, and then forgiveness following baptism through the shed blood of his son. We then receive them into ourselves through their spirit to live and dwell in us for the purpose of mentoring and guiding us. Teaching, mentoring, guiding us through this process of conversion. We have God's love. The agape love is focused on us. We have become the apple of his eye. In other words, what he is focused on. And God has loved us so much he gave his only begotten son, that when we believe in him, faith with works, we will be saved. We may have eternal life. The new covenant is based on a process of reciprocal favor. That love of God and all of his creation and all the favors he's given to us are to be reciprocated to by us, so that we would favor God with repenting and with changing and with obedience and with growing in godliness and developing his character. That is what God wants. The faith and obedience create the character, the fruit that God is desirous. We've examined our responsibility to trust God in this, a God that we haven't seen, that we actually physically haven't heard, but to actually trust and to move forward in faith, in repenting and putting out sin. As we came up to the Passover, we look at, am I really in the faith? Am I really hating sin? Am I really putting sin out of my life on a daily basis? Yes, I am. We go through the Passover and we now find ourselves needing to go on that Exodus journey with Jesus Christ, to be led, to go out of a land of sin, out of a society that we were once comfortable in, and head to a new one. It says in 1 John chapter 1, if we confess our sins, verse 9, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now that is but one vital favor. That is one miracle. However, we are not saved by the forgiveness of our sins. We do not obtain salvation and sit at the right hand of Jesus Christ because he forgave us of our sins. That is a vital favor. However, it opens the gateway for us to participate in this miraculous conversion process, to do our part of the new covenant. Remember scriptures that says, those who are saved or those who receive salvation are those who overcome. To he who overcomes, Jesus said, he who endures to the end, the seed that bears fruit, goats who become sheep, the lawless who become righteous, these will enter into the kingdom of God. We have our part to play. Today, in this final segment of the series on miraculous conversion, in part 4, we're going to examine the purpose and the goal of God's conversion process. What is the goal that God has? What is the purpose of all of this? What was the purpose for the death of Jesus Christ? What was the purpose for the forgiveness of our sins? What was the purpose of all these favors? The purpose is fruit for his harvest. Fruit, people that he can raise up and bring into his family. The final product of all of the sacrifice and the favors that he has given, come home. come home to him and dwell in his house forever. Let's look at this in James chapter 5 and verse 7. This is a wonderful passage because instead of us looking at salvation through our lens, it looks at salvation through God's lens. James chapter 5 and verse 7 says, "Therefore, be persevering." Okay, so the word patient here means to persevere. Farmers don't just go out and look at their land and say, "Oh yeah, looking for a crop." Oh no, there's a lot of actual work to do. You've got to sow that crop, you've got to plow that field, you've got to water, you've got to fertilize, you've got to go out and weed, you've got to go out and protect and take care, and whether it's sheep or cows or crops, there's a lot of work to do. You have to persevere in this. So we need to persevere until the coming of the Lord. That's what Jesus said. You have to endure to the coming of the Lord. We have to persevere in righteousness, in performing the things that produce fruit. Now, from God's perspective, see how the farmer, capital F, it should be, waits for the precious fruit of the earth. What's the fruit of the earth? It's you. Precious. His son. Cost him his son and his son's life. It's cost him everything they've been thinking of and doing, what they are currently doing. The precious fruit of the earth, waiting patiently for it until it receives the early and latter rain. You take the word patiently. What's the early and the latter rain? That's God. Okay? The early rain and the latter rain refers to the festival harvests. The early rain is a rain that comes in the autumn. It's the rain that grows the winter crop that's harvested now. And as it were, the Sunday after the holy day, this feast would be the waving of the first sheaf. That's when the harvest could begin to be eaten. This is the start. This is the celebration of the beginning. And Jesus Christ was the first to be harvested. The early rain and all the work that went into this, all down through your life, my life, we're the early crop that's going to be harvested at the Feast of First Fruits. That's the early rain. So the farmer is waiting for the precious fruit of the earth, waiting or working, persevering for it until it receives the early rain for the spring harvest. And then the latter rain. We've always said, and the Bible teaches, that this first harvest is a small harvest. Many are called, few are chosen. It's just the first fruits who will be resurrected to reign with Christ. It's a small group. Okay? Later, there will be a latter rain. Guess when the latter rains come? Now, in the spring. Okay? Because these are the rains that start watering the fruit trees, they start watering the vegetables, the grapevines. They are going to be harvested in the late summer and early autumn. That's the big, big harvest. And the latter rains start happening now over in that part of the world. Fruit is a result of God living in you, God working in you. It's the rains. The early rains are going on right now in your life. And this is God not just sitting around, or you sitting around. This is what the farmer does. He is working for this crop. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 9, here we see from the apostle whom Jesus loved so much. He loved them all, but he had a special kinship with John, and he says in verse 9, "In this the agape love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him." Not because of him, but through him. This is a mentoring, teaching, assisting growth. "In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. The first fruit, Jesus Christ, that was harvested, is a type of the first fruits to be harvested thereafter. We are to become Christ-like. That is our goal. That's our responsibility. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, and God has loved us, then God dwells in us, and his love is being perfected in us. That is the whole point of the conversion process, is to have God's love developed in us by God living in us. In verse 16, and we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. Guess what you and I are supposed to be? Love. We're supposed to transform into what God is. Like Jesus said in Matthew 5, verse 48, be you therefore like your Father in heaven is. And he who lives or dwells in love dwells in God and God in him. We can see now how this takes place, what the goal is, where to become godly. Love has been perfected among us, or is being perfected among us, in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. You see, this is all about fruit, and if we have the fruit, we have boldness in the day of judgment. Paul said, I have fruit. There's a crown of righteousness laid up for me. Oh, and for everyone else with the fruit. Okay? So, this is a good thing. Because as he is, so are we in this world. We're like God. We are love. We are developing agape love. In Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22, we can now see how this scripture fits. Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22 talks about the result or the fruit of having God living in us. His living in us, guess what? If God is love, what do you think is going to happen if he's living in you? The fruit or the result of God's Holy Spirit is love. That's the fruit. That's what God has wanted us to be, like him. It is agape love and joy and peace. Peace is from the Greek word eirene, E-I-R-E-N-E, meaning to join, not to be at peace. It means to join. God is about oneness. Jesus Christ prayed to the Father in John 17 that we would be one, they would be one, them and us and them, that type of oneness. We would be agape. We would be love like they are, dwelling in one another, as we just read John say. That's the result of having God's Holy Spirit. And it's also long-suffering. Jesus was long-suffering, and we're called to suffer long with others, with kindness and goodness and faithfulness, with gentleness and self-control. And those who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. And if we live in the Spirit, let's also walk in the Spirit. We need to then be on this journey with God and going forward, marching out of any other type of philosophy and into the mindset of God. Now let's go to John chapter 15 and verse 8 and hear from Jesus Christ about God's goal for this process of conversion. What does this process end up as in God's eyes? What's he looking for? Well, in John chapter 15 and verse 8, by this my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit, and so you will be my disciples. What he's saying is here, God desires you to bear fruit, to be like him, to develop this nature. But notice here, so if you do, then you're like me. A disciple, you see, was like the master. He came and learned, but he also became and took on the customs and the understanding that his teacher had. So he said, if you become like God, you'll be recognized like me. In fact, he went on to say that if you love one another as I've loved you, then by this all men will know that you are my disciples. In other words, you're like me. You're my mentees. I am mentoring you and you're becoming like me. So this is the goal that God has. What did he want us to bear? A tree? No. A stalk? No. Did he want us to grow up and have shiny leaves and flowers? No. People tend to think we can do something with God's Spirit. God wants fruit. And in a sense, he wants seed. And it has to be dead. So that's the one side of it. Seed dies. And it is gathered in. And then someday we are resurrected with new bodies. But that seed must be gathered in. If all we had is the plant, either tree limbs, trees, stalks of wheat that had no fruit, that's gathered and burned. God wants the fruit. So by the end of your life and my life, we should resemble God in our character. We should be living that way of life in a permanent way. And so we will be able to then be resurrected. And that fruit is very valuable to God then when it's resurrected in spirit beings, powerful, mighty. You know, as we've read in 1 John in this series, we shall be like God the Father, for we shall see him as he is. I believe that's in 1 John 5. That's amazing. That's what God wants to do with that seed. Now, fruit is interesting. Fruit is something that is unique. It's different. It is always with seed. It's really the seed. And if you consider, say, a tree with leaves, I was visiting one of our members' ranches here, and I forget how many scores of fruit trees are out there. And the fruit trees this time of year don't have any leaves on them, but they're budding. Okay? So it's not the tree that we're after, it's the fruit. And that fruit will be unique in that it'll have luscious red cherries. And some of it will have peaches, apricots. There will be lots of apples, colorful apples. They all contain seeds. And the seeds have an interesting dynamic with humans. The tree needs to get its seeds taken somewhere. Humans just happen to like to take that fruit somewhere. And it works out well for both. And you and I are to produce things that are useful to God. One of the two most cultivated fruits in the world, believe it or not, is the pomegranate. The pomegranate comes in second to the apple. But number two, evidently, is the pomegranate. Maybe not so much in our culture here. But the pomegranate originated in the Near East, or the area of Palestine. And it's still very big in that part of the world. In fact, it's expanded quite a bit. But the pomegranate is in the Bible. When God speaks of a fruit, one fruit that he specifically mentioned is this pomegranate in a very important context. Let's go to Exodus chapter 28 and verse 2. Exodus chapter 28 and verse 2 speaks of Aaron having an outfit made up for him that is very holy and very special. It has many different things to it. I mean, it is really, really special. If you want to read the entire chapter, I'll just mention a few things. In verse 2 it says, "And you shall make holy garments for Aaron your brother, for glory and for beauty." And this is God who designed the outfit and the garments. This elaborate outfit included the Urim and the Thummim. It had precious stones that were engraved with each of the names of each tribe of Israel. So this garment was something special to God that he designed, he created. He had the names of each tribe written on it. There was only one symbol that I've been able to find that was embroidered on this garment. There were a lot of decorations, embroidery, a lot of things like gold, a lot of special things, but there was one item that was an art form of something that exists, right? And it was the pomegranate. Let's notice here in verse 33 of Exodus 28. And upon the hem of this garment you shall make pomegranates of blue, purple, and scarlet all around its hem, and bells of gold between them all around. Literal bells were hung, made of gold were hung. Notice, a golden bell, then a pomegranate, a golden bell and a pomegranate upon the hem of the robe all the way around. Notice why. And it shall be upon Aaron when he ministers, and its sound, the sound of the bells, its sound will be heard when he goes into the holy place before the Lord, and when he comes out, that he may not die. This is a very important element. What do you think the pomegranate was about? In verse 36, notice it was engraved, a plate of pure gold on it was engraved, holiness to the Lord. It's very important to God, this whole outfit and everything, including the pomegranate. Let's take a look at this unique plant and its fruit. A pomegranate bush or tree has spiny branches, and it's extremely long-lived. It lives up to 200 years. So the thing that is producing this fruit is, in a sense, ancient. It only grows in drier climates. It is unique that it's going to produce something without a lot of water, but the end result is going to be a very special fruit. The leaves are glossy. The flowers are bright red with up to 7 petals. The fruit provides people with nutrition during a needful time of the year. These don't come out in the summer when the apples and other fruits and the garden is producing. This comes out at a time of year when people need food. It comes out in the autumn through the winter, autumn through the early winter. You can begin picking them in late September up through February. They're cultivated in drier climates throughout the Middle East, the Caucasus, Africa, India, Central Asia, Arizona, and California. Drier climates. The edible fruit is actually a berry. It's one of the aggregate berry families. Each seed has a surrounding water-laden pulp. This is where it gets interesting. You're in a dry area at a time of year when there's little food, and suddenly you have fruit that has water in each little cell. In John chapter 15 and verse 16, there was a time when you and I had no life in us. We hadn't done anything of any merit in God's eyes, for sure. And Jesus said, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should remain." It's interesting that God calls you and me in a dry, Holy Spiritless environment. You know, the world doesn't have God's Spirit in it. And so in that sense, it doesn't have the water of life. It's a dry place. It's a barren desert, as it were. And yet God has called you and me to come out of a dry place and be water, have water, be watered. He chose us out of sin, out of a society that does not have holiness, his righteousness, and appointed us that we would go and have righteousness. How do you do that? You can only do that through the miracle of God providing it, of him being the tree, of him being the branches, and us being the fruit. And he has appointed us to go and bear fruit, and that fruit should remain. It's interesting that when you look at the pomegranate, it's designed and created in a way that all that water inside is retained and sustained in a dry environment because of the shell and the sacs inside and the insulation that those seeds sit inside. It's a very fascinating thing. And here, God has given you and me an opportunity to bear fruit in a dry wilderness, that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give you. Seeds and fruit, that's the goal that God has from this miraculous conversion process. It's a challenging process, but it's a light burden with the favors that God gives us. You know, a tree that is in the middle of dryness, that has its roots down into a water source, it's all set. Doesn't matter what the weather is, it's ready to go, and it remains. And God is a God of Holy Spirit, a God of character, and when we are attached, then we also grow in those favors. I'm fascinated by this garment of Aaron in that it was the fruit around the bottom, a special type of fruit of people whose names were written on that garment that were going into an area that was a bit on the dry side, that would rely on God for their water coming out of rocks and rely on them for the bread of life. That's like you and me. And yet an amazing fruit, a fruit that endures, a fruit that nourishes, that replenishes at a time when there's not much else there. Our commitment requires a daily involvement, a daily participation. With all the favors that God gives, with all the help, with the Holy Spirit, with the miracles, with him making all things in life to work for good, you and I have no excuse for dropping out or failing. No excuse. Let's see how John the Baptist or John the Baptizer would speak of this in Matthew chapter 3 and verse 10. Matthew chapter 3 and verse 10. John says, "And even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees," trees that don't bear fruit. "Therefore, every tree which does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. And I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and or with fire." That's the theme we just read in verse 10. We can be baptized with God's Spirit. Water, receive God's Spirit, we can grow and develop fruit. Or if we don't produce good fruit, we can be cut down and be baptized with fire. Either way, the sin goes out, okay? One way or the other. We want the baptism of God's Spirit. We want to be washed with the water of his logos. We want to be enriched with his life, with his Spirit, and grow like him. But if we cut off that water, we don't want to grow, we don't want to become godly, then there's fire. And we will be thrown into a lake, get it? Baptized lake of fire instead. And we can pay for our own sins in that sense, because that is the penalty for sin, is eternal death. Notice in verse 12, his winnowing fan is in his hand. People don't like to think of Jesus coming back like this. The winnowing fan is in his hand. And he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Now, I don't say that to depress anybody. I say that because it's written in the scripture. It's a good reminder that our covenant here involves conversion. And we have agreed to a process by which we either will be converted or we will be obliterated. Jesus explains this in the 7th chapter of Matthew. Notice verse 11 of Matthew chapter 7. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? He provides the favors. What should we be asking for in life? New car? Or God's nature? You know, which one will last longer? You get a lot more miles out of the nature, eternity, out of the character that we're here to build. Therefore, verse 13, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. I always like to think, wow, what a boring thing to go in the broad way. That's so boring. But narrow is exciting. Difficult, well, that's challenging. You know, they make sports gear. You can go down to the shop and buy yourself some sports gear, some mountain gear, some bike or whatever it is. It's hard. It's tough. People line up for that stuff. This is good. Jesus said, you know, my burden is light. It's maybe that refers to ultralight backpacking, which I'm a personal fan of. The burden is light, and yet you can accomplish things. You can go uphill. You can have a great time with God leading, guiding. Let's drop down to verse 13. Oh, we are already there. Let's go on down. Verse 15, he says, beware of false prophets. You'll know them by their fruits. Verse 16, you'll know them by their character. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? God's not going to be mocked. He's not going to pretend that there's fruit where it doesn't exist. Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. In verse 19, every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them. But he goes on, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, has the fruits and shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, oh, Lord, Lord, we've come up with other ways to get in the kingdom. We preach the gospel. We prophesy. We teach in your name. We use your name a lot. We cast out demons. We do many wonders. And he'll say, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lovelessness, really, because the law is about love. So it's agape-lessness, lawlessness. It's not the right mindset. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, this is the positive side, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. Okay, so far we're great. Love to build houses, nice house, design it, build it right on the rock, you move in. It's like coming into the church. It's exciting. We had a baptism here this week, and it's really great. The house is built on the rock, and you think, oh, nice view. Everything is all set. Okay, hang on. Hang on, because this is the way he describes it. He says, verse 25, and then the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house. Are you prepared for that? Because that's part of the difficult, challenging, winding way. But if you built a good house and it's on a good foundation, guess what? And it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. That's a good thing. But we have to realize that Satan doesn't want us to win. Our human nature doesn't want us to win. Our own physical state sometimes doesn't want us to win. We have to endure and persevere in this and build fruit that remains. And that's a wonderful thing. It's a good thing. Nothing at all ever is bad about godliness, about agape, about love. In the 13th chapter, in verse 23, it says, "But he who receives seed on the good ground is he who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit, and some produce 100-fold, some 60, some 30 times what God had sown." That's what God wants us to do, is bear much fruit. And we can do that if we receive the seed on the good ground. Let that grow. In verse 26, "When the grain had sprouted and produced a crop, then the tares also appeared." Oh, here comes some more rain and flooding and wind blowing, and now we have tares appearing. So the servants of the owner said, "Did you not sow good seed in your field? How does it then have tares?" Lookalikes. Fruitless lookalikes. And he said, "An enemy has done this." Well, guess what? God's field is his church. The enemy, he says, is Satan, the devil, later on. And Satan can actually put people or thoughts in people or disillusion people to seed his church with a false lookalike kind of a mindset. He said, "Do you want us to go gather them up? Kick them out." He said, "No, lest while you gather up the tares, you uproot the wheat with them. Besides, they might have a chance to change from tares into wheat. Let both grow together until the harvest, and at the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, first gather together the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn." God wants pure, clean fruit that's like him, not look-alike stuff, not stuff that sort of uses the name and maybe the Bible and uses a bunch of stuff, but it really doesn't develop his nature. What is the goal of the new covenant? Let's look in Romans chapter 6, verses 19 through 23. We can see this so many different ways. And in one sense, it kind of gets boring. This series, in some sense, has had some repetitions in it. You know, there's various elements of the process of conversion that carry over and get repeated, and some of the scriptures get reused even. Let's notice what Paul says here in the 6th chapter of Romans in verse 19. "I speak in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you presented your members as slaves of uncleanness and lawlessness, leading to more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves of righteousness for holiness." This is an indebtedness, a slave that's indentured by choice. Nobody made you come into the church. Nobody made you get baptized and forced you with a gun at your head to accept that you would work on your sins for the rest of your life. We are slaves by choice. "When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regards of righteousness. What fruit did you have then in the things of which you are now ashamed? But the end of those things, of course, is death. But now, having been set free from slavery to sin, you have become slaves of God by choice." Remember we said, I don't know how to live. I don't know how to choose. I don't know how to direct my steps. "Forgive me and you lead me. So now you have your fruit to holiness and the end, everlasting life." That's the goal here of all of this, is holiness, godliness, and the end, living it forever. "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord." How is this possible? In the next chapter, chapter 7, verse 18, Paul here speaks of this. He says, "I know in me that in my flesh nothing good dwells, for the will is present with me. But how to perform what is good I don't find." I really appreciate this about the Apostle Paul. I really appreciate him leveling with us and not setting himself up as some sort of perfect guy who is just, you know, untouchable. We can't relate to him. What he says here is, what really exists in your life and mine. We want to do these things. We talk about doing these things. We can't always find a way to do them. We can't always even think about, even on the Sabbath or on a holy day, and speak about the things that we need to be speaking about. But we want to. We want to. He said in verse 19, the good that I would do, I don't do. The evil I would not do, but that's what I end up practicing. Now, if I do what I will not to, it's no longer I. In other words, it's not my will, it's not my practice to do it. He's not justifying sin here. He's saying, it's not my practice. That's not me. That's not the new man. But it's sin that dwells in me. What are we supposed to be doing during unleavened bread? Getting sin out. Getting the leaven out. I then find a law. Evil is present with me, the one who wills to do good. For I delight in the law of God according to the inward man. And I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, which is the law of God, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. Oh, wretched man that I am! Who will deliver me from this body of death? Well, and he answers it, I thank God the Father through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's who will deliver me. We've got to keep going down the difficult road. We've got to get up and put one foot in front of the other. We've got to keep making progress out of our Egypt and do that every day of our life in putting on this godly mindset. So then with the mind, I serve the law of God, but with the flesh, sometimes sin. In conclusion, let's take a look in 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3. We see that we have the ultimate responsibility of becoming what God has invested all this in. The actual final desire for all of his miracles, for all of his sacrifices. It's children like him who have developed character like him over the long haul. In 2 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 3, he says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. It's a wonderful thing that you and I have. We can rejoice as we march out of sin, as the Apostle Paul set us examples, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. You who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed at the last time. Yes, miracles from God, ongoing, that help produce his agape love mindset in us. That is the purpose. How is this accomplished? In verse 6, in this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold to God that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So that faith, with that works, in other words, that character, that fruit, is very, very precious. And it's going to be praised by God, honored by God, and given glory, brightness, at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen you love, yet believing, you rejoice with joy, inexpressible, full of joy, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your lives. This is really fantastic stuff. Now let's go to 2 Peter. In 2 Peter chapter 1, we see how the miracles of God produce and get us to that ultimate state that God wants us to have. In verse 3, We see his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. There are those gifts once again. You've been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature. That is the fruit that he speaks of in 1 Peter 1. How do we do this? How? Verse 5. Also for this very reason now, we give all diligence. Do you want to be diligent? The Israelites this week had to walk. To get out of Egypt, they had to walk across half of Egypt. They couldn't just pretend they were standing with their toes in the Red Sea. They had to move. They had to follow Jesus Christ. They had to follow God the Father. Diligence, and add to your faith virtue. Yes, we believe, but now we have to be virtuous, and to virtue, knowledge, truth, studying God's word. To knowledge, self-control. Self-control is one of the fruits of God's Holy Spirit. Now we're beginning to develop what God wants. To self-control, perseverance. Persevering in all of these things. To perseverance, now godliness. We are attaining a character of God in godliness, but we're not there yet. And to godliness, brotherly kindness. We now begin with our words and our actions to be kind, and to brotherly kindness, agape love. And finally, we see through a process of conversion an end product that God has wanted from the beginning. He is love, and he wants us to become love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Unfruitful, you won't be. In verse 10, therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble, for so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For this reason, I will not be diligent to remind you always of these things. Yes, Paul repeats himself. And Paul reminds us again. He says, though you know and are established in the present truth, I'm going to remind you. Yes, I think it's right, as long as I am in this physical body, to stir you up by reminding you, knowing that shortly I must die. Verse 15, moreover, I will be careful to ensure that you always have a reminder of these things after my decease. I'll write them down. And that's what we were actually reading here today. In verse 17, for he received from God the Father honor and glory, when such a voice came to him from the excellent glory, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And we heard this voice, which came from heaven, when we were with him on the holy mountain. And so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed, as a light that shines in a dark place, or as water that comes in a dry desert, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Brethren, we have a wonderful covenant that God has presented us with. We have a wonderful future with full promises of glory, eternity, and God with us every step of the way. As you perform the new covenant and its requirements with God's help, as he mentors you, as he directs you, as he develops his nature in you, remember, the ultimate goal is to develop his holy, righteous character, for that is the fruit of God's harvest.